This is what's behind those 9-digit Social Security numbers we're all supposed to memorize. Social Security checks from Uncle Sam. Around $4.5 billion worth go out every month to 28 million persons. The aged, the disabled, widows, dependent children. Most of it goes in payments to the 21 million men and women who have reached the golden years. If you have a number and if you live long enough, eventually a check with your name and number on it will wind up in your mailbox on the 3rd of every month.
Mail's done. Come and get it.
And then, as a Broadway show tune put it, the fun begins.
Guaranteed income, house with a view, doctors and nurses, surgery too, everything paid for, and it comes true when we're 65.
Do you think you could live on $75 a month?
If they're going to refuse to pay me, Medicare, to 76 and a quarter, I'm out of that.
Emma, I don't know how long Medicare will pay for you in the nursing home.
I ain't got no money. What can I do?
With my expenses, with the 2 checks, it's impossible to eat with 2 people.
CBS reports, you'll get yours when you're 65. With CBS News correspondent Hughes Rudd.
10, 20, 30, then we're 40, wait till we're 65. No need to hurry, not a worry left but to keep alive. Not another premium to pay. All we've got to do now is play and play. 6 years or 7, then to heaven, me first, the record show. You get the pension, not to mention Blue Cross until you go. If you ever thought you had fun at 21, wait till we're 65.
Wait till we're 65. Well, Mary Baum and her husband Ben reached 65 8 years ago. They moved to Florida, where Mr. Baum retired from his job as a salesman and bought this house for $9,950 cash. That left them with $20,000 in savings. Last year, when we visited the Baums, their combined Social Security income was $236 per month. Mr. Baum, at 73, worked at odd jobs.
My need for odd jobs is caused by the fact that I am on Social Security, and Social Security is not quite enough to take care of necessities. I've been taking jobs, taking care of elderly and sickly men. Another job that I have right now is delivering magazines to doctor's office for a local business concern in which they have merchandise advertised.
The money that he earns goes into our regular fund for buying groceries and paying bills, and if it amounts to very much, well then maybe we put some of it in the bank to write checks against, but otherwise we keep it to pay for our daily expenses. We usually buy about $15 worth at a time when we go shopping for food, and then Ben picks up different things at other places. We go to the day-old bread place for bread, which is very good. We freeze it, and it's just like fresh when we use it. And we watch the sales in the papers and do the best we can on food. However, we can't afford the best steaks or anything like that. We live conservatively, and we find that chicken is one of the cheaper, better things, and we enjoy chicken, so we have chicken a great deal.
We buy milk in gallon quantities, because it's much cheaper that way. I use the full milk, you know, but my wife buys instant non-fat dry milk, and this size makes 20 quarts. We sort of offset the situation of low Social Security payments and high prices for various items, especially the necessities, by staying home at night. For instance, instead of going to a movie, we've been here over 14 years and we've gone to one movie since we've been here. If we are not working at church deals or if we are not singing in the choir, we are at home reading the paper, reading magazines, watching TV, and playing Scrabble or cribbage.
And we buy about 2 papers a week, on Wednesday and Sunday.
And if it was up to me, we would have no phone. But my wife, you know, women like to talk over the telephone, and I keep telling my wife when she does call, never mind asking the questions, ask the questions in a letter, because in our circumstances, it's one item that we could do without.
I think a telephone is very necessary.
Now, if we knew when we were going to die, then we wouldn't be too concerned about whether the money that you have is going to run out or not.
We went back to see the Baums this year and asked them how they're getting along.
Well, the first thing I can think of is that we've received a 20% raise in Social Security payments. We received $236 between us before the raise, and then it went to $285.
Do you find that your grocery shopping, your eating habits have changed much?
Not too much, because there isn't a sufficient raise to allow that.
What about your health? Has it been all right? Have you had any problems?
No, we're both pretty good.
I feel real good now, but my dear wife forgets that about 5 months ago I had a triple operation, double hernia and...
Appendix.
I was in the hospital 3 days.
Did those operations cost you anything?
Yes, it cost me $233.
Of your own money?
Of my own money.
And how much did Medicare pay?
Well, Medicare paid 80% of the total amount of the hospital and doctor's bill.
Have you been doing any more odd jobs? I remember you were delivering magazines to doctor's offices, I think.
That's true. In fact, that's the way we keep above water, so to speak.
Weren't you all fussing with one over whether or not to keep the telephone or to get rid of it? How'd you finally resolve that?
Well, my telephone is very important to me. And one thing, since we have the raise in Social Security, I call my family up north.
Occasionally.
Well, oftener. You don't fuss about it like you used to.
Well.
He thinks that's kind of an extravagance, but really I think it's worth every cent it costs. It really is to me.
Are you still taking the paper only twice a week?
Well, she made me take the paper every day since we received the raise. I mean, that is one of her failings. She loves to read.
Well, what would you like to buy if you could afford it?
Oh, I would get all new living room furniture, if that's what I would like.
Why don't you get it?
Because Papa thought it was better to be able to pay your bills if you had to go to the hospital. Of course, that runs into money, and I think that's at the back of his mind.
The Baums, of course, are by no means an average retired couple. Not everybody on Social Security owns his own home outright and has $20,000 in savings. The fact is, some 5 million of our old folks are forced to live almost entirely on their Social Security checks. And despite increases amounting to 52% in the last 3 years, those checks today average only $273 a month for a couple, $164 for an individual. It's no wonder that according to government estimates, well over 1 million of our elderly married have incomes of $50 a week or less, and 4 million more of our old people have incomes of $40 a week or less.
I cannot meet my home expenses on these 2 checks. The only thing I have got, I pay rent, $65 rent. I pay for my electric.
There's nothing the Social Security people can do about the size of the pensioner's check. That's up to Congress. But the local Social Security office is handy, Congress is not.
My check was 97, and my wife's 90-something. All right, was before her check was raised. With my expenses, with the 2 checks, it's impossible to eat with 2 people.
While some people don't find much security in Social Security, others do.
I'm 78 now, and I'm retired 14 years, and I think it is wonderful. Social Security, that we fought as young people so hard for to establish that in America, is now a reality, and it helps very, very much.
No matter how little you get or how much you get, I think we should be very grateful. However, we did donate to it, but it was compulsory. Otherwise, if it was voluntary, I don't think any of us would have been able to achieve what we're going to get. And I think at this point, with Medicare, it has given us the opportunity to live longer and healthier and less worried to our family and children. And I think most of us have more peace of mind now than we ever thought we would have as we grew up all these years.
Well, do most of you find that you can live on the checks you get from Social Security?
I didn't depend on it, actually, and so I prepared myself and cushioned myself against adversity. And with me, it's just a windfall.
Not many people can get by on Social Security alone. And those of us who have a little savings can get by all right on the normal things of life. But the bad thing is when we need teeth or eyeglasses.
This pair of glasses cost $80. Plain glasses. $20 doctor's prescription and examination, and $60 at the Webb's optical. And all I get $105.90 a month Social Security.
No, all I can add is that Social Security is a disgrace in America. I think it is. To the we poor people that need it most. And I earned it, the little bit I have.
Why do you say that? Because you can't live on it or what?
Do you think you could live on $75 a month and buy drugs and just manage to get around?
That's 880, 410.
It's one of life's many little ironies that when we reach the age when we most need prescription drugs, eyeglasses, and teeth, we can least afford them. The elderly, who constitute 10% of our population, buy almost 25% of the medical drugs sold in this country. And they pay for most of them out of their own pockets.
Does this, having to pay for the medicine, does that wreck your budget pretty much?
I get 93 cents Social Security, $93 Social Security. So, you know, it keeps you busy figuring how to get along.
What is the medicine for? What is it?
Spine.
She has arthritis in her spine, pretty bad.
Well, I wonder if sometimes toward the end of the month, do you have a tendency to not take as much of the medicine as you should in order to make it last a little bit longer?
Yes, but then you feel it. You see, that takes effect on my back. Those pills, and if I drop off, then I get more pain.
What we'll do is we'll take an application for the Medicare. Now, as you may be aware, there are two parts to the Medicare coverage.
30 years after Social Security was introduced in this country, we finally got a health plan added to it. The plan became law in 1965, is called Medicare, and last year paid out almost $9 billion for the aged.
Now, the fee for Part B of Medicare, the medical insurance, is currently $5.80 a month, and then effective July, it's going up to $6.30 a month. There is a $60 deductible, that is, you pay the first $60 in your medical bills, and after that, we pay 80% of all reasonable charges.
This doctor takes Medicare assignments, which means that his fees comply with the fee scale that Medicare considers reasonable. But if Medicare decides the doctor charged you more than what it considers a reasonable fee, you pay all the unreasonable part as well. Last year, 54 million non-hospital claims were filed, over 90% of which were for doctor's bills. And in 11.5 million cases, the old folks were stuck with what Medicare considered unreasonable charges.
Now, we're not saying that the doctor shouldn't have charged this amount. I mean, this is up to the doctor. He's a self-employed person. He can charge what he wants to, but we do have to limit the payments that we make under Medicare.
The way I feel, I paid out to a doctor at 175. I'm out to see the doctor, ain't I? I'm out of it.
People on Medicare not only have to worry about whether or not they'll be hit with unreasonable doctor's fees, they also live with the harsh fact that Medicare pays only 42% of the old folks' health costs. And because of the wherefores and whereases of the law, it's often difficult to know what Medicare will pay for.
Now, the charge on that was $30,
right?
But they denied it. The therapy was done as a rehabilitation point. And when Medicare feels that you have reached a certain level of whatever it was they were giving you the therapy for, that it is now maintenance therapy and not rehabilitation type.
I'm sorry. KTC Admitting, Ms. Walker speaking.
May I have your Medicare card, please?
In the hospital, you pay the first $72 yourself. Then, if you need to, you can stay in the hospital up to 60 days. It costs you $18 a day from the 61st through the 90th day. After the 90th day, it gets more expensive and more involved.
Come with me, please. Yes. Oh, that's it.
While in the hospital, you must, of course, pay 20% of the reasonable fees charged by your own doctors. Now, all this can be expensive, and that's why, all too frequently, many old people find themselves paying large bills out of their own pockets when they leave the hospital, even after a short stay. Rightly or wrongly, some 11 million old people distrust Medicare's promised blessings so much that they carry supplementary private health insurance at prices many of them can ill afford. This is not to say there have not been blessings from Medicare for thousands in this country whose illnesses fit the regulations. But for thousands more, Medicare is a mixed blessing indeed.
Emma, you don't need what we call skill care anymore, and you can't be taken care of at home. So the doctor says you need a nursing home. I think we can get you one. But I don't know how long Medicare will pay for you in the nursing home.
But I ain't got no money. What can I do?
Well,
all I get, the last 2 months, I get $52.20. Before that, I was getting $42 for the last 4 years. My money ran out 4 years ago.
I see.
I've been retired for 36 years. I've been in hospital, this is 7 hospitals, 12 times.
Don't you have any money in the bank?
I haven't.
Nothing.
I had 30 cents that was in my pocketbook.
I will bring a paper up so you can sign an application for state aid, because Medicare just will not carry you in the nursing home.
I ain't got nothing to pay for
this. You have no money?
No,
well, in this case, what we're going to do is put you in for state aid, because Medicare will just not pay for you in a nursing home situation. And, you know, your wife can't take care of you at home.
Well, I don't give a damn where I'm going. I go to hell for what?
No, you got...
I'm dead.
No, you're not.
I'm a dead jerk.
No, you're not. Why don't you want to go to the nursing home?
I don't want to. I've never been in one, and I don't want to go now. Mm-hmm. I've never been one in my life. I worked all my life. I come to this. I don't want to go.
Okay. Eli, let me tell you, we can't keep you in the hospital anymore after this week.
Why not?
Because you don't need the hospital anymore.
Well, they'll have to do something. I don't even say what to do. I can't help myself. I'm too weak. I say more. I'm going to stay right here.
No, you can't stay here because, Eli, if you stay here, you will not be on Medicare in the hospital.
No.
They'll have to cancel your Medicare because the doctor's discharging you. You're going to have to go to a nursing home.
Well, send me some cemeteries
there. Many old people are not considered sick enough to remain hospitalized, but they do need skilled nursing care. For those, there is no charge for up to 20 days of nursing home accommodation. The patient pays $9 per day from the 21st to the 100th day. After that, the patient pays it all. The catch here is, what's Medicare's definition of skilled nursing care, and who needs it? George Jackson is a retired newspaper pressman. Now 81 years old, he and his 82-year-old wife, Bertha, retired to Florida 17 years ago and paid $8,700 cash for their house. That left them with $12,000 in savings. The Jacksons get $275 a month Social Security plus $25 from Mr. Jackson's union. They were doing all right until Mrs. Jackson went blind. A year ago, her back began to pain her, and she became bedridden. Then, more trouble.
Well, the missus became blind and then helpless and had to go to the hospital. After hospitalization, she went to the Palms of Pasadena Deluxe Inn nursing home. And after there a few months, we were notified that she was cut off from Medicare payments, that her condition didn't require the payments because of the different categories they got to cut patients off. Therefore, we had to pay ever since, and the bills run very high. From $600, 1 month I got a bill for $1,013.
Well, let me ask you this. How much have you spent so far?
So far, approximately, I would say about $4,000 or $5,000. More or less, I don't know. I haven't kept too much track of it. I get the bills, they must be paid, or in 21 days, they put the patient out on the family, they call it.
Well, how much money have you got left in the bank now?
I have a burial fund, which I wanted to keep, of $4,000. But now this month, I have to pay and take some of that to pay for this month's bill for Mrs. Jackson. She's been such a wonderful woman all her life. And she has children, grandchildren. And it would be a pity if Grandma couldn't be well taken care of and given her the care she deserves.
Hi, honey.
Hello, honey. Where was you so long?
Waiting.
Waiting.
I was a little late today.
Oh.
Yeah, I was held up for a little bit. Would you like a piece of chocolate?
Yeah, oh, you know us.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a favorite. Chocolate.
Yeah.
Good. If it takes all our life savings, if there is no other way, there is nothing else for us to do but trust the good Lord that something will come along to help us out.
The latest word from the Jacksons is that their savings account is now down below $1,200 from their original $12,000. Mrs. Jackson has been moved to a cheaper nursing home, and the Jacksons are now on welfare. In spite of the fact that the real business of Social Security is human beings, the laws and rules regulating its application are of an almost inhuman complexity. As a result, our own perceptions of Social Security are also complex and frequently false. Some people, for instance, think that if they'd ever had a Social Security number and made any Social Security tax payments, that they'll get some kind of Social Security check at 65. Wrong. Some people also think they'd automatically have been better off if they'd invested the money themselves instead of paying it in Social Security taxes. Wrong. And they think they paid much more in Social Security taxes than they have. The fact is, if you'd been in the system from its very beginning, 36 years ago, and had paid the maximum amount all along, your total payments as of right now would come to a little more than $5,000, which isn't such a bad deal so far. But unlike the income tax, there are no exemptions. A man too poor to pay income tax still must pay a Social Security tax. And he pays at the same rate the rich man pays up to the maximum tax base.
Regardless of income, a single man pays the same tax as a married man, but receives only 2/3 of the benefits paid a married man, who gets an allowance for his wife. Then there's the married woman, who works and pays Social Security taxes. She's entitled to benefits in her own right, or as a wife on her husband's benefits, whichever amount is higher. Since there's a good chance she'll receive more from her husband's benefits, the Social Security taxes she paid all of her working years will have gained her nothing. But can the married woman, who never went out to work, count on sharing her husband's Social Security checks in old age? Well, she can if they stay married 20 years. If they're divorced before 20 years, she's out of luck. The person who's forced to work to supplement his Social Security check is penalized for anything that he earns above $2,100 a year. But the man next door, with $50,000 a year income from investments, gets his full retirement check every month as long as he doesn't do any work. Well, there are lots of other qualifications and sub-qualifications, and if you have a question, Social Security publishes dozens of booklets like these. Now, we don't mean to imply that these books make everything perfectly clear. This one, for instance, is intended to answer the question which probably first occurs to everybody. How much will I get when I retire? Well, the answer goes like this. Count the number of years to be used in figuring your average earnings as follows. If you were born before 1930, start with 1956. If you were born after 1929, start with the year you reached 27. Count your starting year and each year up until, but not including, the year you reach 65 if you're a man, the year you reach 62 if you're a woman. List the amount of the worker's earnings for all years beginning with 1951. Do not count more than $3,600 for each year, 1951 through 54, $4,200 for each year, 55 through 58, and so forth. They're revising the booklet now because of a recent change in the law, and it will get even more complicated. For help in trying to understand all this, you can go in person to one of the 900 Social Security offices around the country, or you can call them up.
Well, you have Medicare?
So many people call up that the agency has established telephone banks like this one in Tampa, Florida, which serves 10 counties, taking toll-free calls, answering questions, questions, questions.
No, sir, you can retire when you're 62 at a reduced benefit if you'd like to do that.
So let us check and see if your widow's benefit under the new law will be higher than what you're receiving on your own Social Security record.
Well, you apparently had not met your deductible. Consequently, there couldn't be any refund on it.
Yes, ma'am. In order to be covered under Medicare for a nursing home, you must be in a hospital for at least 3 days.
If you had remarried and you're 60 now and you're unmarried now, you can still apply as long as your status is unmarried.
Do you understand me so far, ma'am? Okay. Now, for the first 20 days, Medicare will cover it.
This phone bank receives an average of 10,000 calls a week from puzzled men and women. Social Security has come a long way since its beginnings, but any major improvements have always come only after bitter struggle.
Medicare no longer covers it.
Had it not been for the Great Depression of the 1930s, it's doubtful we'd have gotten our Social Security law even when we did. It was passed in 1935 and was a child of the Roosevelt New Deal.
We have tried to frame a law which will give some measure of protection to the average citizen and to his family against the loss of a job and against poverty-stricken old age. It seems to me that if the Senate and the House of Representatives in this long and arduous session had done nothing more than pass this security bill, Social Security Act, the session would be regarded as historic for all time.
Many native-born Americans thought at the time Social Security was an original and radical idea. Many may still think that. But the fact is, 29 countries around the world had Social Security systems before we did. And today, almost 40 years later, most of them still do more for their people than our system does.
It all began in Germany back in the 1880s under, of all people, that ultra-conservative Bismarck, the Iron Chancellor. He introduced the German Empire to Social Security in order to head off what he called the socialist danger. And even under Hitler, during the depths of the war, improvements were made in the system. In West Germany, as in the United States, Social Security has grown increasingly comprehensive and complicated over the years. In both countries, about 90% of the population is covered. In both systems, the taxes paid by the employees are matched by the employer. Germans pay between 13 and 14% on a base income of about $8,400. Americans pay 5.85% on a base income of $10,800. Both systems offer medical care and retirement benefits. To pay for these benefits, both governments contribute to the cost. The West German government about 15%, the United States government about 4%. Although the West Germans put more into their system, they get much more in return. And they get it sooner. Under the West German system, a worker and his dependents can get Social Security benefits even while he's working. In the United States, for you or your dependents to receive benefits before retirement, you must die or become permanently disabled. In Germany, for instance, health care, including dental care, is available to everybody of every age under the Social Security system at no extra charge. And, as in America, one can choose his own physician. In West Germany, those under 65 make only a token payment for drugs and eyeglasses. Those over 65 pay nothing. If the German worker gets too sick to work, his employer must pay him his full salary for the first 6 weeks of his illness. After that, the government will pay most of his full salary for a year and a half if he's incapacitated that long.
Well, what about the man over here in the corner? What sort of problem has he had?
He has been in this hospital for 1 year now. And he was admitted to the hospital for hip replacement. And then unfortunately, when he was recovering from his first operation, he slipped and fractured the same leg again. And we got that fixed, and then he fractured his leg again.
Well, having been in here a year and with, what, three operations?
Oh, I think it was more. Six. It was five operations.
Five operations. Yeah. But no matter how long this lasts...
No matter how long this lasts...
He still will have this sort of care.
That's right.
For no money, in effect.
For no money, no.
In West Germany, the Social Security system worries about your health even before you get really sick. Wherever there's a mineral water spring in Germany, there's a spa where the rich and famous used to come to drink and bathe. Today, the German working people are there, on doctor's orders, all paid for by their Social Security system. Feeling a little run down? Job getting to you? Nerves somewhat shot? Well, explain that to your doctor, and if he thinks a cure would be helpful to maintain your health and working ability, he will probably prescribe a rest at a cure house or rest home. There are more than 200 of them, run by the various retirement pension funds, and they seem like a cross between a convalescent home and a country club. This cure house is in Bad Pyrmont. Here, on arrival, everybody gets an electrocardiogram. And if the doctors think he needs it, a circulatory test.
Hier sehen Kohl.
Diabetics and others with dietary problems are given instructions about what to eat and what not to eat. Once in the cure house, the worker must stay for a month, and he can stay 6 weeks if need be. While the rundown employee is recharging his batteries, his employer must keep on paying him his full salary. Once the Heron folk are rejuvenated, they are ordered to take 2 more weeks back home for a kind of recompression period before going back to work. All this is not for retired people. It's for those still working, no matter what their ages. The idea is that by keeping the worker in good health, he'll keep on working. Early retirement, of course, changes a productive worker into a non-productive pensioner. Under the German Social Security system, the German worker can begin drawing his full retirement benefits at 65, whether he keeps on working or not. He can also get his full pension at 63 if he's worked 35 years. The average worker's pension amounts to around 50% of his last working wage before retirement, which his government doesn't think is high enough and plans to improve. Also, pensions are adjusted upward to keep up with wages. The result is that men who've been retired for several years may find themselves drawing more money in retirement than they made on the job. In this country, the Nixon administration feels our government is spending too much money on health under our Social Security system. The administration feels that the system is being abused and wants to make some changes in the law which would force the elderly to pay more of their health costs. The reasoning is, if the aged are made to pay more for medical care, those who don't really need it will think twice before they seek out medical care. We are, after all, the richest country in the world, and we'd like to think we're concerned for our old folks. But we have, perhaps for too long, held too single-mindedly to the idea that the Lord helps those who help themselves. While in other advanced countries around the world, Social Security systems were developed which display much more compassion than our own. Well, if we're lucky, we'll all get old someday, and the way things have been going ever since the Stone Age, it looks like we'll all need all the help we can get. So you'd better plan ahead if you can figure out how, because you won't be too secure with Social Security alone. This is Hughes Rudd, 499-16-9967, and like me, you'll get yours when you're 65. Good night.